the mom and the daughter. It's all a tight family structure that is the foundation of the entire Bible message. How many people really get that message today? Well, according to this prophecy, not very many, or we wouldn't have this dreadful day of the Lord. It wouldn't be there. We would be repenting and God would come and it'd be much more pleasant for everybody. I mean, all the way until he sets up his rule. Now, once he sets up his rule, well, that's going to be pleasant for everybody in spite of what people may think. They're going to come around and they're going to see that it's right and that it's good. Now then, let's look at verse 6 again, and let me read that to you one more time. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. The Hebrew means smite the inhabitants, and that means the inhabitants in the church or in the world, for that matter. It is, as I said, a dual prophecy. But you see, the curses come only if we don't receive the message. But he does say, God does say, well, now if that message isn't heeded, I'm going to bring curses on the inhabitants and on the people. Now, do we believe that? Do we have the courage to face what God is saying here? I'm talking to myself as well, because I have the same human nature you do. We all have. But are we willing to face what God says to bring all kinds of blessings into our lives and get rid of the curses? Are we willing to face the truth of God? Are we willing to face these prophecies and see how that we need God's help? The nation, let's say America and Britain and even the Jews in the Middle East, the British peoples around the world, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, have serious crime problems, divorce problems, drug problems, every pathology you can imagine. It seems that we have. And family split ups and splits and all of that. And we also have, certainly at this time, some bad weather coming on the scene. And the Bible says that God controls the weather. And yet, we do see that there are droughts, and there are droughts where it just withers the plants and the shrubbery and the trees and all of that, and we have terrible fires, and we have floods at the same time, or too much rain and floods at the same time, which is the fulfillment of a prophecy. But surely, one of the great blessings we would want from God and should have from God is good weather, because there are all kinds of difficulties, all kinds of suffering if we don't have good weather. That's something that anybody can see very clearly, and it doesn't take a lot of explaining. If you look at Amos 4, which is one of those prophecies that this Elijah talked about so often, it says there, that God says there in Amos 4, that he's going to cause it to rain upon one city and then drought in another city. I mean, that's a prophecy from God. That's just one of the curses that he talks about. And after he lists five curses there in Amos 4. And after each one, he says, yet have you returned not to me, saith the Lord. God said that five times in those curses there. He's saying, yet you haven't returned to me. In other words, God does it, tries and tests us so that we'll return to him. We get away from him. And we certainly have in this end time. And those are prophecies in your Bible, and that's an end time prophecy. I'm just telling you what is in your Bible and how you can bring blessings into your life individually, or a nation can, or nations can, or the whole world can, if they just heed those warnings from God. how can anybody believe the Bible and not be alarmed by this message and at the same time inspired by it? Because the trouble and the problems we see in our societies are really a sign that the Messiah is about to come. That He's about to come to this earth. And He wants to fill your life with blessings. Now that is the Bible message. God isn't cruel. He's a God of love, and He only wants to give blessings. But sometimes He has to try and test us, and that becomes a blessing because it turns us to Him. But the lesson in Amos 4 is, well, we ought to turn before these things get so bad and learn the lesson that God is trying to teach us. Notice Matthew 16 and verse 28, and we'll notice what this Elijah says in the New Testament and what it says about him. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in His kingdom. Now this is a vision that they're about to see, that God is about to show them through Christ. Verse 1 of chapter 17. And after 6 days, Jesus takes Peter, James, and John, His brother, and brings them up into a big mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and His face did shine as the sun, and His raiment was as white as the light. So this is Christ being transfigured, and His face shines like the sun, and His raiment is white as light. Now that's, God says, that's really the way we're going to look if we obey God and turn many to righteousness, get behind His message before Christ comes. Daniel 12, verses 2 and 3. And then He says, now if you do that, if you turn many to righteousness, you're going to shine like the stars forever and ever. And like Christ shines here. That's our future. Now, you see, that's a life of blessings, where God really does fill your life with blessings. But notice verse 10 and 11, where before this becomes reality, a man comes on the scene, a type of Elijah. And notice what he did. Verse 10, and his disciples ask him, saying, why then say the scribes that Elijah must first come? Should read Elijah. And Jesus answered and said unto them, Elijah truly shall first come and restore all things. He's going to come and He's going to restore all things just before the coming of Christ, or the coming of the Messiah, the second coming of Christ to this earth. He's going to restore all things to this church. And then you can read Acts 3 where then the church is going to help Christ restore all things to the whole world. Now that's what He does in the end time that is so remarkable. And I mean, if you're talking about all things, it shows you the wretched condition of God's own church when He came on the scene, but it shows you the wretched condition of all religion because, well, where was the truth? Where were the doctrines of God? It's really quite a condemning statement in that way, but the good news is it's all happening just before Christ returns to this earth. And that's a wonderful message, and it certainly ought to be earth-shaking to all of us, I believe. But how many religions do you know of that really discuss this verse, or these two verses, let's say? How many religions really talk about it? And it's one of the most pivotal prophecies in the New Testament. Perhaps the single most pivotal one in the New Testament. Or a two-verse one anyhow. Why isn't it discussed? Why isn't it talked about? Do people understand it? Do they want to understand it? I mean, this is a solution to all of our problems in this world. I mean, all of them. And we could solve them even today if we would listen to the message of this end-time Elijah, or the type